So thanks, folks, for coming. This is an information session hosted by the board and Avatar, who is our, who are our contracted assessors and have been for quite a while. I don't even know how long, but ever since I've been on the board. And you may or may not know, but the state of New Hampshire, under whom all whatever meager powers we have are vested, tells us that we need to do a revaluation every 5 years. So this is the fifth year. Avatar has started the process, and Chad is here to talk a little bit about process, answer any questions you might have, and without any further ado, I'll introduce Chad
Roberge
from Avatar. Roberge,
very much. So we, as Suzanne kind of alluded to, we kind of already started the process, and some of you have actually already been made part of the process because I was coming through the houses and doing measuring and listing. So what we already have started was the actual measuring and listing and verification of the, of the properties. The reevaluation is actually comprising the models and looking at the sales and coming up with the values. The measure and listing part is a little bit separate, and we are really just verifying the factual data. We're not doing new assessments, we're not coming up with new values. It's just making sure that the what is on the property is what is on the property record card, so that we know that our data that we're using to come up with those new assessments is accurate. So we did the town elected to do the whole town at once, so that's what we started in January. We started measuring and listing every single property. Some of you were home, and we actually got to go through the interior of the house when we were there. And some of you have since gotten letters because you were unaware that we were at the property, verified the measurements, but we send out letters to people that weren't home and didn't have the availability to let someone through. So that's what the letters that went out just recently are allowing you to do. There's a phone number you can call to set up an actual appointment for some time. I believe they're making for next week, Monday through Friday. And you can set it up anytime between 8 and 4 to let someone come through your home and just verify that the information that we have for the property is accurate. And most times it's good to let us through because we might not have been through in 10 years, and if you haven't been making updates, it's good to...
Where is it written that I must let you into my property?
You don't have to. It allows us to come in and make sure that the assessment is the most accurate that it can be.
Now, I've already talked to somebody, I don't know if it was you or not, because I was home.
Mm-hmm.
And you measured, or somebody measured the outside, checked the fact that I had a separate garage, I had mm-hmm. not put any sheds up, done nothing else. But I must admit, I was not happy to get the letter. And I'll tell you why, if you don't mind.
No, the letter asking for an interior?
Yeah. First of all, I thought I threw it in here, and I might not have. First of all, on the letter, it had no real letterhead. It just said Town of Rollinsford. It was on a cheap piece of white paper.
Did we send it out? Or did you
send it out? We sent it out, yeah.
Well, let me tell you, you might be wise to get letterhead stationery so it looks official, and to put it down a little more than it was here, and it's gone.
No, I can tell you, it didn't have Rollinsford's letter.
Didn't have Rollinsford on it, didn't have your company logo or information. It was the cheapest sort of paper one can get for a copier, no offense, but it didn't feel like letterhead stationery.
Mm-hmm.
It went and said you represented Rollinsford, but there was nothing on the Rollinsford had put it on Rollinsford mm-hmm. stationery, that you wanted me to schedule an appointment to come and look at my interior of my house. Now, there's so many other things going on in the world today. It certainly didn't look official. It looked like a scam. It looked like somebody wanted to come in and case the joint. And there was no way you were going to do that without a warrant at that point in time. But in the future, you might prevent some of the people going ballistic, as I did, but making it look a little more official, explaining why. Knowing that it came from Rollinsford, that Rollinsford had a signature on it, because I don't know you, I didn't hire you, I didn't vet you, so I don't know who you are coming to my door. You want to measure the outside, that's one thing.
We can put something on the website that says that this letter that just went out was from.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I mean, I appreciate the suggestion, I just don't know. I think that doing it on the website is probably a better idea, because people look at it, but I don't know if putting letterheads on, because scams nowadays are so advanced, I'm not sure if people.
That's true.
I'm not sure you would have felt any different getting it if it had Rollinsford's letterhead on it.
If I had a Rollinsford signature on it, I might have said, oh, okay, this came from the town.
I understand.
No, I do understand.
Yeah. I get calls from India all the time telling me that I owe money to the Internal Revenue Service.
Yes, so do I.
So it's.
I have cousins that are in jail in Nigeria.
No,
you have to send them money in cash.
Right. My favorite was the lady that said, you're a good Christian woman and I want to send you millions of dollars, and I wrote back. I mean, that one I did respond to and said, you know, when I sacrificed the chicken at midnight last night, it told me I was getting money. I never heard from her. But,
no, I do, I understand.
But this is one of the things that you're dealing with, and I, having worked, you know, with other agencies over the years, it just looked suspicious.
It's
yeah,
a very good point.
It's a good point. No, I think we'll. I'll definitely bring it up and see what we can do to make it.
It could be
more
even
efficient.
A joint letter from the town,
yeah.
And you know, introducing you from the town,
yeah,
as the official. But some, it needed a little more than what it had.
Yeah.
Good.
Sorry.
Oh, well, I'm sure it's been modified, because it used to say improvements to the property. I think we've changed that to say buildings, because people look at that improvement and say, I haven't improved my property by 100 grand. It's not improvements, it's improvements to the land. So we've changed things over the years, so it's probably a little bit different each time we've done it.
Go right ahead.
The question I had, the probably the biggest problem is a lot of the residents didn't get notified before the knock on the door.
Yeah, Suzanne has already brought that to my attention that we should have done something ahead of the DV. That's, yes.
Mm.
Well, it's not the first time somebody's been around to appraise my property, because I bought in 2011.
Yep.
So somebody.
You come out for the sale.
Yeah.
Yep.
Somebody has been, so the knock on the door didn't get to me as much as, hi, I want to come in and look at the inside of your house. And for all you knew, I had nothing but tinfoil to keep the government from listening to conversations. I mean, it's like, who are you and why should I let you over my door?
Yeah.
In all honesty, I haven't really done anything, but, and if you were the gentleman that came to the house, you know, we changed out the kitchen cabinets and remodeled the kitchen, but I see no reason why somebody needs to go through if we haven't filed for a building permit for anything.
And you are not obligated to. It's just a suggestion, because obviously the most accurate data we have for each property, the better the model is when we come up with the assessments.
Well, since my house was only sold in 2011, I should qualify for having all the information.
It should be
accurate.
And yeah.
Mm-hmm. Except my kitchen cabinets.
Did you have a question?
Yes, would
require.
I would like to see the process, the
that's not what I understand.
The assessment or revaluation process more transparent, meaning that, you know, do you have a website that I can go into? I can look at the Rollinsford neighborhood values and.
Well, you're gonna get all that. So, did I cut you off?
Oh, no.
Okay, so what we're going to do, so this part of the process is just the data verification part. The next part of the process is we're actually going to, Jonathan was the other gentleman who was driving around and measuring and listening. He's much taller, more handsome.
Yes.
We'll be driving the whole town, and that's the process, that's where we are looking at the sales and comparing it to the property, every single property in town. We're going to drive every road and look at every property. After we do that, we're going to come up with the new values. We're going to get a new letter, and we'll look into making it a little bit more efficient. But this will have your new values, assessed value on it, so obviously it won't be asking you to let us in or anything. Once that process starts, you're going to get in that letter the ability to log online, and you're going to be able to see everyone's new value. And it'll have all the neighborhood information, where the new values are going. Also in that letter, there will be a phone number to call to make an appointment to meet with the assessor.
Okay, guess I'd like to take that a step further. I mean, the evaluation process, what I pictured, is you probably have a spreadsheet and you probably have a list of neighborhoods and each, mm-hmm. you know, you multiply one, the standard neighborhood of one, let's say another neighborhood, you multiply by 1.2. If a house has 2x6 construction versus 2x4, there's another value added.
Yeah, we don't go into that detail, but we have that. We have those spreadsheets when you come to that meeting. So when you get that letter, the second letter for the revaluation with the new values on it, you can make an appointment, and at that appointment, we will have the spreadsheets that shows exactly how we came up with the base rate for building, land. If there are views, we can show you how we calculate those values for the views, everything.
Okay, but you know that means if I schedule a meeting, I won't be coming prepared. Okay, I like to talk about the data. If I have a question about the data, I like to back it up. I don't want to go to any meeting and complain for the sake of complaining. I want to, you know, look at the facts, the data, and say, okay, this is fair or no. I question at least two items because of, you know, such and such a reason.
The model that we create and use for our spreadsheets is our methodology. So really, your argument shouldn't be coming in as to your methodology is wrong. Argument as a taxpayer should be more like, all right, I got my new value. It says it's 150 grand. I know the two houses down the street that are exactly like mine that sold for 130, and they have improvements I don't. Why is mine at 150? So it should be more, it should be as granular as our spreadsheets. I mean, our spreadsheets should have data that you can use to kind of say, all right, this sale, they gave it good condition because of the kitchen. Mine is average, but it's listed as good. You should use them for that, but I don't know if you just, you shouldn't necessarily need the spreadsheets before you come to the meeting, because that's where you would use that online link to kind of compare your home to other homes. And that's where you would say, all right, there's something wrong because I know these sales are out of whack compared to my own property. And you can get that, you won't have the spreadsheets, but you can get the data in terms of their land value is assessed at 130 grand, its neighborhood is, you know, one, my neighborhood is 1.1. So you can get it there, but it won't, you won't have the spreadsheets because those are all still preliminary. I don't know if that answers your question.
If I could also add on to that, having bought property in 2011, a lot of the information that I pulled up was through Zillow.com or New England Real Estate thing that would not only give you the value of the property for sale, but it would list some of the properties that have sold in the neighborhood, so you'd have some idea of what the going rate is for that type of home in the neighborhood, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. And the online tool is great because you can do searches, so like, and you could search for just sales. So if you just want to know sales in town that happened between 2015 and 2017, it will list all those sales, and you can look at the ones that you know are near you or houses that you know are similar to yours and click on them and see how they can compare. But in terms of getting the spreadsheets before you come to the meeting, I'm not sure that would help you so much because it's more or less you should be looking at sales and similar homes that you think are comparable and making distinctions. And that's what you want to bring to the meeting is, because you can print right out from that website the comps that you were looking at and say, hey, no, I know he's got improvements. Why is my house assessed similarly when he's got a brand new kitchen and I still got one from the 80s? That's what he's doing.
That pertains to, you know, to a different town. If I find one in a different town that's exactly like mine, is that?
Different towns are tough because we've got equalization rates between, you don't know what their values are set up. You can use sales comps, but then it's also tough because you've got different school districts. And ideally, looking at what, we, like I said, we've already kind of started the process. There are now 72 qualified sales in the town of Wellsford. I'm hoping you should be able to find comps.
Yeah.
This is one of the first times, I mean, I think it's only my third time involved with a reevaluation for Wellsford. It's one of the very few times I've come across where we've got comps in every zone. It's been tough to find enough properties in each zone to kind of say, all right, this zone is vastly different than the next. So we've got, it's been a good market in terms of sales in the town.
Yeah, what were you saying, over 65?
Last time I checked was 72 of qualified, which is, I mean, usually you guys are in the 80 range, but a lot of that, I think in the past has been foreclosures or short sales, or just people transferring family, which happens quite a bit. But this year, I think by the time we have the review part done, I'm hoping to have closer to 90, which would be, because ideally what we like to do when we do our revaluation is, we've got, you know, like I said, we've got a pool of 72 sales, we'll create our model, we'll review the whole town, and before we send out those letters, we'll get some more sales to kind of test the model we've created to say, all right, you know, kind of give us some verification that what we have done is good, because the sales came in, hit the assessment, and then that's when we send out the finalized letters just to kind of say, all right, here's where the value is, and then you guys can make your appointments and, you know, say, hey, we did a great job, or listen, I found some mistakes that, you know, I think need to be addressed.
So, could I just, I have a big general question, but also just a comment to all of us about the need for building permits. If we are doing anything to our homes, that we come get building permits, because this is one of the ways that we keep things sort of on track in between.
And also demolition permits, that's a big one.
And the building permits are only for over $1,500 worth of
value.
Define value.
Well, we usually run it for the building inspector, because sometimes people do it themselves, and they're not expending that much money, but the overall value of the project adds that much, $1,500 in value to the property. So we'd like to be able to collect that, so that again we can keep, you know, properties on equitable.
Yeah. But demo's huge too, because like a gentleman brought down his home and didn't tell anyone, and we weren't aware that the house had been demolished and he'd been continuing to assess for it. So demo permits are also, because if we don't know you took down a barn or a shed, you're going to be continued to be assessed for it until we know that it's gone. So.
And there's no cost to a demolition permit.
No, that's the other key
that's
thing.
That's, yes, so that's an easy one.
Yeah.
Now my general question is, so you know the MS-1 that we did in September, whenever we do it, I think we had an assessed value somewhere like 227 million, somewhere around the 228. So just, I'm not going to hold you to this, but just kind of, what are you expecting will happen to the overall assessed value of the town as a result of this?
Looking at what the sales are doing right now, looks like about 8 to 10% increase in value overall. There's always a curve to it, so some will go down more, some will go down or go up more, but, or, I'm sorry, some will stay the same, some will go up, and some will.
Right.
But overall, it looks to be about 8 to 10%. But that's when I looked at it in March, so.
Yeah, so we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see what happens when we do the review out. I think the town changing school districts and just the overall appeal of the town, just, you know, as other towns get congested, Rollinsford being so close to those towns, I think it's really kind of upped the value in the market.
I was going to say, in response to your comment, I was in town today, in the town hall, picking up a building permit. But the town tax collector said the same thing you did. Somebody in front of me had not gotten a building permit, but just replaced something that was already there.
Mm-hmm.
And the tax collector said, next time get a building permit, because the building inspector needs to evaluate the value of that, like how much lumber costs and all of that, even though I'm not spending out of pocket.
Just what value have you added to your property? That's a key that we're looking for, so we keep everybody's assessed value on the best par possible.
Mm-hmm.
So if my bathroom sink has a crack in it, and I replace my bathroom sink, I've got to get a building permit?
Buying a very expensive marble
that would be
something.
No, it wasn't gold plated. This is the hard line with this problem with this line. If you know, you have, and I you know, you have cracked sinks. My home was built in 62. Or you might have cracked tile on the wall that you replaced.
I mean, clearly, right. I mean, there's going to be that, as you say, there, you know, for some there's no problem, either that way or even this way, like a like a bathroom replacement, not a bathroom replacement, but a toilet replacement. And for those things in the middle, we're going to try, you know, we have to trust people's judgment. Maybe that's the best we can do, but, you know, I feel responsible to at least, you know, kind of remind us. And we have had, this board has been putting an emphasis on trying to raise everyone's awareness of that, because they're, you know, if, you know, we're all trying to live our lives, right?
When I did replace kitchen cabinets and did it.
Understood.
Okay.
You probably need a building permit.
I called and asked about a building permit. She said, are you replacing? I said, yes. Now this goes back to a previous
administration.
Yes. And they said, no, you're just replacing it. You didn't need a building permit at that time.
But inaccurate.
But you did your best, so what can we say, right?
Well,
so that's what I mean. We're trying to raise mm-hmm. everybody's awareness about that.
Right.
We put it out with the tax bills, I think, last year. We put it on the website.
The newsletter.
The newsletter, thank you, that's what I meant. So because there have been these sort of misunderstandings that have built up across the years, and so we're just trying to make sure everybody is, you know, kind of understanding.
Because quite literally, I was under the, if I'm just replacing and not upgrading, by adding,
right? Yeah, it was,
I didn't put a pool in the basement. I didn't put a whirlpool tub in the backyard, or whatever. That I didn't need a permit.
Yeah, then it was a misunderstanding.
Nothing
that
I done.
Yeah, if you reshingle your roof, if you put in a new furnace, mm-hmm. I tore out my rug and just put it in laminate. I needed a building permit.
Mm-hmm.
So
great. Now my oil tank leaked, and I had to put a new one in. My oil tank leaked. I needed a new one. Would that require a building permit?
I probably always just come in and check.
Yeah,
sure. Only because, especially things like that, you probably want an inspector making sure that whoever replaced it did their job. Especially with something like that.
Well, I've used Gagnon since I came. It was Gagnon that did it. And I have their number on speed dial if I need them. But, you know, it's sort of like, This is a gray area.
We do have a building inspector who's here, and he's available via email too if you want to zip him a question.
What does he inspect?
He's our code enforcement officer. He inspects like electrical, plumbing, you know, whatever the building.
Okay, so
but he also reviews building permits. So he was the one
okay.
who would be able to answer your questions about permits.
But I didn't know if you had one person that did electrical, and then a different person for plumbing,
no,
and then a different person for construction. I came from a different area that had specialties.
Yes, I know. I've seen the state of Massachusetts, but that's not us. Okay.
I have a question for
sure.
The gentleman from Avatar. Do you get, when you're assessing the different properties, do you get the lot maps to it? Because I live in the old Salmon Falls Village, and some of our lots are very strangely laid out.
Mm-hmm. We have the tax maps. I don't know, is that what you...
Probably.
Yeah, that's, I mean, yes, we look at all those when we're
like,
on review. Yep.
My neighborhood, like, we all own, like, 3 feet to the left of our house, and some of us own behind our neighbor's house or right up to, and so it's... strange configurations
mm-hmm.
in the village.
Yeah, no, we look at that, that's how we route the whole town, is looking at that map. So that, when we're doing that, is when we look at, you know, do the lots have frontage, meet zoning, don't meet zoning, exceed zoning, we look at all that.
Okay.
Yep.
Can I just ask the gentleman who walked in, did you think this meeting was at 6:30?
Yeah, that's what the email said. That's what I was just checking my calendar.
Yeah, so there's, I would say that there's a general confusion. I thought it was at 6:30 myself.
Well, the email said it was 6:30. The one, the town email that you
that's
can subscribe to?
Yeah, so I don't know what the source of the confusion is. But anyway, Avatar will be here as long as people have questions. So, you know, we really are here to sort of answer any questions that you might have. If you want some more background information, I'm sure Chad would be happy to do that as well. So
I mean, maybe one of the questions, is this meant from a town perspective to be revenue neutral?
Yes, in a sense, right, absolutely. So so the state requires us to do a revaluation every 5 years. So this is the fifth year. So let's say property tax values go up 10%. Our appropriation does not go up 10%. So what it means is that at tax setting time, whatever we have been authorized to raise, minus whatever revenue, not property taxes, revenue we've collected throughout the year, gives us the total tax burden. And then we just divide that by the assessed value. So the assessed value will be different. It'll be a bigger number. Some people's fractional part of the total burden will go up. Some people's fractional part of the total burden will go down. It'll be a result of, you know, however, you know, if you have been under-assessed for a while, you probably will go up. If you've been over-assessed for a while, then you're due an adjustment, and this will be the time to see an adjustment.
And that was really my second question. So a particular homeowner's change in their taxes should only be the result of a change in under or over-assessment over a period of time, not a result of reallocation of the tax burden to different sections of the
correct.
Town. Okay.
That's correct. Now, the board is trying to keep the tax burden this year the same as last year. We do that every year. Mm-hmm. But we're working at doing that so that, if possible, we'll be able to tell people there's been no change in what we're raising. So if you see changes, it's because
of the market,
not because
I apologize if people have asked these questions.
That was a good one.
And I guess after the assessment is done, we'll get a sense of a comparison of similar homes.
All right, so I'll go through my spiel that I did just a few minutes ago, and that will probably clear quite a few of your other questions. So we started the data verification process, which is kind of separate than the reevaluation. So someone's already been out to your home, and if you were home, we asked to get inside. If not, we just wanted to verify exterior measurements. You might have also already gotten a letter where most of those letters only went out if no one was home, and it was asking you if you'd like, because you weren't home, would you like to set up an appointment to let us do the interior just to verify the information? When that process is done, and we've got all the information back from that, we'll make sure that it's all entered, and then we're going to start the revaluation process, which means that we're going to take all the sales, kind of create a model as to see what's changing. Is the base rate for the houses changing? Is the land value going up or down? And then we're going to review the whole town and compare every single property to sales that we have to see where it fits. You know, is this colonial in nicer shape, better quality construction than the sale that we have? That sort of thing. Once we complete that process, we're going to send out new letters, and that's where you're going to get your new value of the house, so you'll see whether you're going up in value or down in value from last year. You'll also have a username and password in that letter that will allow you to go online and see new values for every property in town if you want, and you can also see the more, because on that letter it just shows you land value, building value, features value. So if you add them all up, you can get the total, but it doesn't really get too granular as to how those values were derived. If you go online, you'll be able to pretty much see exactly what your property record card would look like. You'll be able to see, you know, the neighborhood that you're in, and you can kind of compare it to other houses and make sure that, you know, I think this neighborhood is similar, make sure those are in a similar neighborhood. You'll be able to see the sketch of your home and make sure that that looks accurate. You know, are we assessing you for a finished basement and it's really unfinished? So that's where you can kind of go on and make comparisons, not only make comparisons, but data check to make sure that...
That's what I was going to ask. So you can get a sense of... If the thing that to be exorbitant said that there were three bathrooms and there really only two, you're able to see that detail. So
yep.
it's not real granular, but you have a certain set of criteria that go into doing this.
Yep, it's pretty much this. It's as granular as we make it in terms of how we derive the assessment. So if there are errors in that, what you see online, there will more than likely be changes to your assessment.
And or other than. Especially on the interior side. I mean, for example, would a house on the exterior, would a house with a new roof be assessed differently than the exact same house with a roof that's 10 years old?
Yes and no. So those are, that's, we like to make it as objective as possible, but there are parts that are subjective, and that's kind of one of the things we try to make it as objective as possible. If you just do a roof, like if you've got two colonials and one just puts a brand new roof on, and let's say prior to that, we consider them average condition. They're built in 1970, mm-hmm. they haven't really had any updates. Well-maintained, average condition. If one puts on a brand new roof, that might be enough to push it over to like a good condition, but if that's the only thing they've done, more than likely it might stay as average, because you're not really, it depends on what they do. Like a roof isn't, obviously it's protecting the home, but it's not, in terms of cost, it's not a huge added investment. If you redo a kitchen and bathroom, that will definitely kind of put you up over the edge. It depends on what we kind of see in the market, okay. Really. But that's one of those things where we hope people are making comparisons. So when we send out those values and you're looking at your neighbor and you're like, they just did a kitchen and roof, their house is in as good, we're in as good, and we are still dealing with what we bought, you know, 20 years ago. That's what we're hoping people come in with and say, hey, listen, okay. We think you made a mistake.
So the process, there'll be a process to either as a group like this or as a homeowner to sit down and kind of, not nitpick.
I'm sorry to finish. In that letter with the username and password, there'll also be a phone number you can call to make an appointment with myself, okay. Or the other gentleman. Obviously not that day, further in advance in the future, so you can kind of come in with all your, it will give you enough time to look through all the comparables and kind of come in with an argument.
So I didn't know the assessment started already, as far as you visiting homes.
Yes, so the data verification had to happen before the reevaluation. So we've actually already gone out to every single property, measure and listed it, and if people were home, we asked to get inside, and yeah. Hopefully got inside.
I did get the letter. I'm surprised we weren't home, but I don't, you know, you might have missed it.
And you're not obligated to, but it's nice to get inside, because like I said, the models we create are only as good as the data we have. So obviously, I mean, I love getting 72 sales because that means we can make a pretty solid model that makes sure that as the market changes, even though the assessments are static, the assessments are in the same ratio as the market. So whether you look at a sale that happened 2 years ago or 3 years ago, you can still, or in the future really, you can see that it's equitable because the ratio between the two. So that's
okay.
Good. So getting in the home and making sure that we have the most accurate data really helps the model hold out through the 5 years and make sure that, you know, we're not missing anything.
I mean, it sounds like if somebody has a well-maintained home inside, it doesn't sound like it's their advantage to let you in though.
Yes and no. So what we look at when we're doing the review process is how long has it been since we've been inside the property. I've done, I think, up to 3 reevaluations, so I've been doing it for 15 years in this town. And if I'm looking at that and I haven't been inside the home in 10 or 15 years, I'm going to estimate that there's been some updates. And that's not to be mean to you as a homeowner, that's to make sure that other taxpayers who are letting me in aren't being overburdened because someone else isn't.
Okay.
And that's why we do it during the reval process, because you as a homeowner have the ability to go online, see what we've done, say, oh wait, how come I'm in this good? So you do have that ability to come in and say, oh wait, before you get taxed, hey, I think you made an error.
Okay.
So that's kind of how we, I don't want to say catch people that haven't been letting us in, but that's kind of how we try to make it fair for everyone that does let us in.
I've another general point of information I'm going to rely on you to correct me if I don't have this just right. But,
try.
So the New Hampshire Department of Revenue Administration, or DRA, is the State Department that manages, you know, all of our financial operations, and they're the ones who actually set the tax rate based on the information that we have given them and a lot of stuff. And so one of the things that the DRA does with regard to a revaluation process is they will do an audit of some sort. Subsequent to this process, they'll pick a certain number of properties and just kind of do a double check. Do I have that? Did I say that correctly?
No. They take about, I think it's 10% of the cars, it's 10% or 20, whatever they hit first, which is usually always 20. And they'll double check to make sure that we're doing our job. They go out and make sure that we are being fair and equitable, meaning that, you know, if we're assessing this person for generator, that we're assessing the next person they come to with the generator, that we're not being inconsistent. And they want to make sure, they also take a look at all our spreadsheets that we come up for the reevaluation. They go through the whole manual to make sure that, one, that we did what we said we did, and make sure that it also holds up to standards. So as a result of this reevaluation, actually, after all our appointments with taxpayers, we are going to produce to the town all the new property record cards with the values, as well as a fairly large manual that will have everything that we did, how we did it, the math that we used to get there. You'll probably want to go through it, because it sounds like you're the very granular type person. So it goes through exactly what we did and how we came up with all the values. It's got all the base rates, where we got the base rates from. It outlines everything. And that the state goes through, and they go through and make sure that, you know, we did everything we said we did, and that it seems kosher. And they also look at the equalization ratio. So as a result of this reevaluation, we're supposed to make sure that the assessments are equal to market value, meaning that the ratio is 100%. There's no difference. There shouldn't be any difference between the assessment and the market for this year.
Right then.
And then it starts to change. So.
So that's, to me, that's just, you know, it's another comfort level, another layer that gives us some confidence that this process is, you know, as fair and equitable as we can help make it.
Another question. Do you look at, I bought my house in 2011. The website listed the construction and the roof and the basement and, you know, it had all that stuff listed on a real estate site. Do you check those up?
At the time of the sale, so when we did our sales verification for 2011, we would have looked at MLS. We would have also tried to go out and knock on the door.
Somebody did come, and I mean, I know this is the second time I've been caught.
Yes.
But I didn't know how much you look at that, because I had no idea
what's
under my walls. Yeah. I mean, it could be.
No, we look at that, and then for the process of this reevaluation, though, we actually only try to go back 2 years to kind of come up with a model, and we time trend those. If we get enough sales in the year that we're doing the reevaluation, we'll just use those, which I'm hoping we can do in Rollinsburg, because that obviously that means that, you know, we've got a solid model. But if we have to go back 1 year, we might. But we look at come up with the sales pool that we're going to be using for the reval. We go through all the MLS listings to see what it was listed as having, what has happened since. Absolutely. Because we can't get into everyone's home.
Well, not just that. As I said, they listed what was, that it was stick built, which, again, it came from a state where they're not all stick built because it had more termites than anything. Yeah. But I don't know what's in the walls. I don't know how far apart the, whatever they call those beams, or supports are. And that would make a difference in the value if they're 16 or 18 inches. Now, that's information short of tearing on a wall. I can't give you it, but it might have been on the real estate information.
Maybe, if they had pool permits.
Well, I don't know. The house is.
I'm sorry.
The house was built in 62 by the homeowner.
Yeah.
So I have no idea what they did in 62.
Well, hopefully.
Then there would be
planning on living there the rest of the
plan life. Somewhere.
There should be plan. Okay. Then there are plans somewhere. Yeah. But the homeowner built the house, so.
Well, we try to do the best we can looking at real estate listings and everything. And then we rely furthermore on the homeowner when they come in to kind of say, hey, you know, this is the evidence I have. When we tore down this wall to add a kitchen, we found that the studs there were only 18 inches on the center. So we look at all that.
All I can tell you is my appraiser, in looking at the attic, said, no, it's fairly well built.
Yeah, that's good.
Because that's still.
What's your address?
I'm just under the assumption when you say in the 72 homes that you're going apples to apples, not new homes and old homes.
Yes, we're going apples to apples. When we're pulling up to our every property, we're looking at sales that are comparable, not. No, we're not comparing a one-story ranch to a two-story colonial. It's comparing like homes and saying, all right, well, no, this is a similar ranch, but it's got overhangs that sold for this. This one's got no overhangs around the house. It's a little dated, and we're making the comparisons that way.
But I'm also saying new homes that were just built in comparison to older ones that were already.
Yes, but that's done through, obviously, the year built and the depreciation. So when we come up with our spreadsheets, we actually try to figure out what is the depreciation per year based on sales. So if we have a ranch that was built in 1985 and a newer home, what is the difference in that building value over the period of time?
How do you take into effect when the codes change?
For zoning?
No, when the house built in 1950, it's going to be built under different codes
sales.
And one built in 2012.
If the sales show that someone's willing to pay, you know, 10% more for 2x6 construction, then we'll assess it accordingly. But until I see market data to suggest that, so my job is to make sure the assessments are equal to a market appeal. So if, you know, like one of the things we're dealing with now is solar. Does solar add value?
I typically like to
see what the market is showing. If the market is showing that yes, solar panels are adding value, then we'll assess it. But until I see differences in, you know.
I ask because I know, again, I came from out of state and I apologize because I used to hate it when people say, but back home.
Yeah.
A newer house would be appraised at a better price than a house as much as 30 years old because the building standards had been improved so much.
Well, I think that's...
And I came from a hurricane heavy zone. So,
yeah.
You know, there is some of that, but I know the zones change.
Yeah. I think that kind of gets taken care of in the year of the construction. So like when we do our spreadsheets and we're seeing, you know, jumps between decades, that's when we say, all right, well, maybe we've got to make some sort of distinction between the years more heavily. And that, it could be because the house is old, it could be because of the difference in construction. There could be a lot of factors, but if we try to deal with it in the age of the home and quality of construction too. So if we are seeing higher quality construction for certain homes, obviously there's a, there's an area that we can adjust, which you can see between your home and the neighbor's home. Typically neighborhoods are similar quality construction because it's same builder or same type of home.
For a little development.
Yeah. I live in a hodgepodge, thank you.
So my house that is built 200 years ago is not going to be assessed at the same value of the houses going up the block away from me that are being built now.
It shouldn't be. If you have completely brought down the house to sticks and redone it, like new insulation, new windows, new walls, everything brand new, it'll be close, but no, you shouldn't be assessed at the same as the brand new home. No. I should say the house shouldn't be. If you've got 100 acres and the guy on the street has only got 10, then it could be a different thing.
How long is there time-wise between the time we get the letters and the time the appeal process occurs?
Well, you'll get the letter, and then we usually, from when we send out the letters, from when you have to start calling, it's usually about 2 weeks. Week or 2 weeks, and then when we start getting the calls, we usually try to schedule them either the next week or the week thereafter. So you've got it 3 or 4 weeks between when you get the letter and when the appointments are going to be made, and that's a preliminary. So nothing's been set in stone at that point. Things can still change after the fact. Once the meetings have concluded, and we kind of go back and, you know, we might have drastic things we need to change because of those meetings. If we really miss the mark on something. We'll make our changes, we'll send out a finalized letter with the new values on it, and at that point you'll have to wait for the abatement process. So we're hoping to set the values in, you know, we're hoping to hand everything over to the town at the very latest by October. They'll do the bills, you know,
as soon as possible.
And then at that point you'll wait until March, or I'm sorry, when you get the first bills, when you get your December, November bill is when you can start to file your abatement if you still feel like the value is amiss.
So you're saying the final one will be in October, but we'll get preliminaries before October.
Oh yeah, yeah, the preliminaries I'm hoping to have to you, to the residents, praying for July. I don't see why we shouldn't be able to do that.
Okay.
Well, you have everything by July. We'll hope to have everything done before then, and then we kind of wait. You know, I don't want to wait until obviously the end of October to hand it over to someone, but I want to get a few more sales to kind of verify that the model that we've done is working. And then we send out the finalized letters to deliver to the town, and then they'll bill as soon as possible, and then you can do the abatement process.
Jen?
So hopefully, because of the preliminary process, we like to alleviate all those abatements.
We'll be hosting those meetings here, right?
Correct.
People
yep.
will be coming here if
yep.
you wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
Good. So do you assess all of the properties in town, not just the homes?
Every single one.
Because I know in the past 2 years, the planning board has changed a couple of the buildings in the village district to mixed use. So they're going to be assessed probably different, right?
Change the use of the building or the
mm-hmm.
land?
The use of the building.
The, a couple of the mill building and the blue and building across the street.
Oh, yes. Yes, those are assessed. Yes. Yep. That's one of the things we're looking at in the sales. So we've got sales in zones that are kind of showing us what the land values are, comparatively speaking to other zones.
I'm not sure that it was, as I'm rethinking what you just said, I mean, I think what I thought Celia was asking is, so if you've got a building that was zoned one way,
mm-hmm.
and now we've just changed it so that you can put residential units on the top floors, don't you, doesn't that change the highest value that you can expect? And doesn't it make a difference in the assessed value
mm-hmm.
or not?
It depends on the building and I think the short answer is yes. In most instances, if you're changing the use to include more, it's going to increase the value.
Yeah.
In most cases, we try to do an income approach to those if we have the right data. So like an apartment building, we usually try to get, you know, what they're getting for rents, or what their expenses are, and then we try to figure out what the market rent is for town. So
if they haven't actually done that yet, they might not see if it's still just a...
Well, we use market. So if they've got 80 apartments, we're going to use, I think right now it's right around $800-$900 per one or two bedroom apartment in town. We're going to use that to value it. And then it's up to them to give us, we'll come up with general expenses from what we see in like data in town. But if their expenses are different, it's up to them to give us information as to, you know, actually it costs us this to maintain the building.
Mm-hmm.
But we try to use market data. So that building, the blue building, is that going to be apartments?
Blue building? It's been zoned for that potential. Mike can tell you exactly what
the
zone is.
So the commercial one zone and the mill zone went from strictly commercial to mixed use.
Who
built it to have mixed use? None of the properties have said they are going to do that yet.
Oh, okay.
So it's just a change in the zone. So the question is, when it went from commercial to mixed use, the ability to then add residential as well, does that change the assessed value?
Probably
different
not
question.
For the mills, only because my guess is for them to change to that use, it's going to be astronomical cost. So more than likely, the highest and best use for them is to stick with what they're doing, which is renting out sites for businesses to come into or artists to come into. The building across the street, because it's built to current code, it's probably not going to cost them anything to go one way or the other, so I'm not sure that the value will be that different, depending on whether it's apartments or offices.
And the change will occur in March. So.
Yeah, so I'm not sure, because they have that availability, it depends on how they build the building itself and what standards it would hold up against.
I think the thing is it's going from a manufacturing building to a mixed use. And that would be,
yeah.
even
oh, I
to
think
put.
Because it's a brand new building practically, I think we're going to have to look at it.
Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
It's going to be gutted. The whole building's going to be gutted. So.
When you assess property owners, are you assessing accessory buildings like barns and stuff like that too?
Yep. Everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think there's any exceptions. Except for like... The carports that are canvas, the canvas carports we don't usually pick up if it's just like the typical steel tubing that just sit on the ground.
Let's see. Because they're movable.
Chicken coops, though, we pick those up, unfortunately.
The last gentleman I spoke to, I think, who was the other gentleman, I said, well, what do you do about chicken coops? And he said, well, what were you thinking? I said, well, you know, they have these little portable chicken coops that you can move around. He said, no, that's not considered a permanent structure.
Yeah, if it's one of those like small doghouse ones with like a ramp that comes down, that's not.
But the regular chicken coop that's built.
Yeah, those we would pick up, for sure, if it's
good.
A shed type quality.
So if you put wheels on it, doesn't
matter. Windows.
Yeah, roof and windows.
Yeah, roof, windows.
Heat.
So my bathroom that's still in the 80s with the gold is actually left.
It's coming back. In today's market, people wouldn't really expect that. They'd kind of expect updates. So that's where you kind of fit into the average. Mm-hmm. So if you're looking at your house and we have you as good or very good, I'd probably make an appointment to come listen up.
Any other questions?
Yes. Was a market analysis performed?
That's what we're going to be doing when we do the revaluation. So that's when we're looking at all the sales and creating the spreadsheets and coming up with their base values. So yes, it will be. It hasn't yet.
Anything else?
So in other words, all you've actually done is looked at the property and measurements. You haven't done any assessments yet.
We have not done any of the modeling yet. We've looked at the sales and verified the sales information and gone through the listings to make sure that the data for the interior of the sales is as best as we can get it. And then obviously we visited them and asked for interiors. That's as far as we've gotten so far.
Because I know 18 months ago I had mine reevaluated for a refinance, and it ended up, the real estate ended up $4,000 less than what my tax bill was.
Oh, really?
So it's like, okay. Well, there'll be a difference when.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd wait to see what your new value is going to be, and then that could be something you bring in for argument. Yep.
Anything else?
Can you specify the 72 homes that you're saying are up for sale? Are they majority?
They sold.
Are they the majority existing homes, or do you know the majority new homes, or you're looking at both?
I can tell you that. I would say most of them are pre-existing, like they're not brand new. I know we've had a few on Scouts. We've had quite a few vacant land sales that was surprising, one very surprising, which is good though, because that. I mean, that typically in a town like this, you don't have too many vacant land sales. To have that all in a revaluation year, that's great, because we can come up with base land values. But I couldn't tell you how many of, I would say very few are brand new homes. Most of them are going to be pre-existing. Not a lot of new development.
Anything else? I want to say thank you to Chad, and thank you for coming. We hope that this has been helpful.
No problem, it's a pleasure. Okay.
And next time we'll have a more official looking letter.
Yes, I'll work on this.